Hey folks, this is Best in Slot with all the exciting news for Update 6, the next big free update that's releasing alongside the Feathered Species Pack a week on Friday, the 30th of March. Frontier this morning have posted their next forum post going into detail and showing us some images of Update 6, including a closer look at those new viewing galleries. So really exciting stuff, let's get started. An exciting new addition we have in Update 6 are remote viewing galleries, introducing brand new ways to decorate your pack. We've added two building attractions, the log viewing gallery and the dome viewing gallery. These new building pieces can be placed anywhere in an enclosure to allow your guests to get up close and personal with their favourite prehistoric species. Of course, within the safety of the gallery. And we have a proper image. They gave us a full size image for this one. We've got the log viewing gallery. They've given it even in a Jurassic World style enclosure with the Rex and the goat. And it looks pretty good. It's a little bit more open than the one from the film. So we've got this glass roof and then we've got a double-sided glass wall there. And it looks a little shorter as well. So you can see a doorway there, which does actually resemble the one from the film as well in terms of styling. And I think there's probably a doorway right there. So I questioned this in the video yesterday, how do we do the log? Because in the film, it stretches across the entire habitat. In this one, I think it kind of comes out. You can see the edge of it there, can't you? Like right there on the left-hand side. So I imagine it kind of hangs over here and there's like a foot there. And you can actually see the rivets and the beams there. So there's a foot there on the right-hand side. And it kind of sits there. It's a floating, well, it's not floating, it's got legs. But it's just a rectangle in the middle of your parks. But, you know, put a tree in front of the sides, put some rocks in front of the sides. You could make it look fairly natural. And I think it looks great anyway. It looks really good. Now I want more log decorations in the game as it happens, but yeah, really exciting about that. We do have a little bit more information. The skyzing itself amongst the natural enclosure, the log viewing gallery is as the name suggests. As you can place these anywhere inside an enclosure, you'll need to ensure they are connected to an entrance building using an underground connection. Once they're connected, your guests will be able to journey into these viewing galleries to experience up-close dinosaur interactions. So, not sure if it has to be placed onto the fence in the way that a typical viewing gallery would. If I had to guess how it'll work, it'll be like the zip line or the tunnel system from the Biosyn expansion, and you'll be able to drag this building out a certain amount of distance anywhere outside your enclosure, and then plunk it down and people will enter it and then pop up in the log thingamajiggy. That's how I thought it was going to work, and that does seem to be the case. Speaking of it, yeah, there we go. We also have a glimpse of the viewing dome as well. It's been made quite a lot bigger than the JPOG version. It's kind of got that Jurassic World angular look to it, but it is worth noting. This does have a Jurassic World aesthetic, you would say. I wonder if we're going to go through this again. Are we going to have a Jurassic Park version of the same building? This one you'd probably get away with all of them, given that kind of industrial metal kind of look at the top. But I would be curious, that's a new attraction, and these are confirmed to be in the attraction section, whether we would see this with different variants depending on the era. We'll have to wait and see on that. But yeah, looks really good. Looks shiny. Looks perfect for aviaries, as they've said. Well, as you'll read in a second, but you could put this absolutely anywhere. Now we just need to get them in lagoons somehow, and we're golden. The dome viewing gallery, much like the log viewing gallery, will need an underground connection to an entrance building to work as intended. This particular gallery is the perfect addition to the aviaries. Watch your flying reptiles soar through the air, and if you are lucky, they may even perch alongside your aviary for a unique encounter. You're sure these glass domes will give your guests an entirely new perspective. So you can see we've got these fences, we've got these bars sort of around the aviary where the, assumably that's where the pterosaurs are going to perch. It says unique encounter. I don't want to read too much into that. I imagine it is just they perch and they do the normal perching behavior. But it would be cool if they saw the guests and they kind of like tapped the glass, or they actively looked down into the glass or something like that, to play with the new attraction, to play with their behaviors a little bit more. I'm not going to overly read into that because I know we do that quite a lot. But yeah, it looks really good. I love the little details. You know, I've got a vending machine in there. I've got some little benches. And I think hopefully we can hop between each of these parts as well, or at least four different ones. And it's going to give a really cool view of the aviaries that we just have never had before. They do seem perfectly suited for it. Right, so that's our first look at the viewing galleries up close. But there is more to Update 6 than this. Some really cool stuff, actually. So let's dig in. We now know what cinematic camera mode is. For those with a keen eye for photography, we've added a new cinematic camera mode. We can't wait to see what you do with this new feature. The cinematic camera will allow you to transition between camera angles and viewpoints across your park to instantly snap those picture-perfect views and exciting interactions between your prehistoric species. This mode will be accessed through Capture Mode, and you'll be able to add existing overlays, your stamps and postcards and stuff like that. Make sure to share screenshots when you get a chance to try it out. So, this doesn't necessarily, I think, fully explain what it is. If you've played a sports game or a racing game or anything like that, and you're watching a replay, hell, I think even Planet Zoo, if you put your camera onto an animal, there you go. If you put your camera, sorry, I've got my drop shadow on. You put your camera onto an animal and you turn on cinematic mode or whatever it's called, what it'll do is it'll change the viewpoint constantly, or every like 10 seconds or so, to give it a cinematic kind of feel. So sometimes it'll pan over it from the top, and then you'll get like a straightforward angle, or like a ground shot, or like a sweeping camera that moves in that sort of direction and tracks the animal in that way. That's what a cinematic camera is. And if you play sports games at all, you'll have seen this quite a lot. There's quite a few other styles of games that would use a, inverted commas, cinematic camera. I'm a little annoyed with myself, I didn't pick up that lingo, and that's obviously what it is. This seems like it's an interesting one. Transition between camera angles and viewpoints across your park. You're going to activate it in capture mode, and then it says it allows you to transition. It doesn't say it automatically, does it? And get interactions between your species. What I'm hoping for is that it'll have like a social interaction setting or something like that, and every time your animals are socially interacting, get pops over to that animal, or maybe every time your animals are hunting, it will pop over to the hunting animals, something like that. This is really one we need more information and we need to see in action if we're really going to figure it out, because this is not that much information really, but very curious about it. I'm still sad I'm not going to get my slow motion camera though. Anyways, moving on. A couple more things to show. We do have glimpses of those new zip lines, so it's confirmed there's two more added to the game. The one on the left is the DFW version, and the one on the right is the Jurassic Park version, which I really like the look of. I understand this is actually quite a lot of work necessary to do this. You know, it's a whole new model, essentially. Yeah, you've got the basic layout, but still, there's a lot of work involved, and they've even got like a different winch going on here, kind of like a more classic Jurassic Park-style Dennis Nedry winch. Got that sort of darker panelled wood, and we've got like a little bit more angle here on the Jurassic Park version. It's cool. Variants of the zipline attraction have been added on the... have been added. You can choose between the new DFW zipline or Jurassic Park zipline to decorate your parks with. These variants will be limited. You'll only be able to mix eras again on modern consoles and on PC. And on PlayStation 4 and Xbox, you'll be able to choose between either for your parks. So that's about what we'd expect. But yeah, they look fantastic, and just more decorations, essentially. More attractions, essentially. And then finally, we're going to talk about sandbox mode, which has been expanded yet again. The big one, the key feature, there's two key features. One of them is right here, and that is unlimited feeder reserves. Unlimited feeders in sandbox. Cannot believe we've only just got it. It seems very late for such a key feature, but we're finally there. And let's talk about this. We've got quite a lot to go into. So, 6 new square levels. Again, this hasn't been explained, but I think my guess as to what this is probably correct. 6 new square levels will be available for you in Sandbox that are all based on the 6 different biome types in the game. Southwest USA, San Diego, and California will also be getting 3 expanded square levels. That one's very interesting. I think... Okay, so what I think with the 6 square level... God, bloody... drop shadow. Get rid of that. What I think the 6 square levels are is... I'm just going to cut this into 6. Okay, I'm going to cut this into 4. Imagine the 6 of these. And these are all the different biomes. So you've got like a frosty one, you've got your deserty one, and yada yada. You've got all these different biomes. And it's just a square. And maybe you'll have some terrain around the outside. It would be cool if it was water around the outside. A little bit of JPOG love. But I think it'll be terrain and mountains around the outside. And you are just getting a big flat square for you to build your parks. That's how I'm interpreting it. That's the logical way to interpret it for me. I think Southwest USA, San Diego, and California will be the same thing. It's just that they'll have very specific... The terrain on those 3 levels is quite impactful. The Southwest USA one's got those huge... cavernous, you know, Grand Canyon kind of style things going on. San Diego, of course, has the water and the city nearby. California, up in the mountains, again, some beautiful views. And has all these mountains around. So I think that will be just the same deal, these big square levels, but with more terrain, specific terrain, on the outskirts. That's my guess for what this is. Again, we don't know. They have mentioned we may find out more about this in the stream, and they're streaming tomorrow. So hopefully we'll get a look at them. I'll be able to bring you that information. Some more settings in Sandbox are being introduced. So unlimited feed reserves we've seen, which is great. You can unlimited feeders, that's cool. Income tax, which just means if you want to make your Sandbox experience a little harder, you can now ramp up income tax as well, just like in Evolution. Wild capture frequency, for those who... I've seen some people confused by this, people who clearly have never used the setting. If you turn on fossils and stuff in the Sandbox and then you've got your wild captures on, basically it's kind of like in the campaign where you get an alert every now and again, you know, 17 baryonyx have been found mauling a child in Connecticut. Let's go get them kind of thing. Oh, like they've been found in the wild. And you take those 17 baryonyx and you put them into your park. That's the general idea. So you can increase or decrease how often that happens. I really like the idea of turning that up to high and doing like a pure wild captured dinosaur only park. I think that's really fun. And decoration foliage. So it does actually go on to say what this means. Lastly, the decoration foliage settings will allow you to use foliage from all biomes or the level specific biome as you choose. This will only be available on new generation consoles. I'm assuming that also includes PC, because it wouldn't make sense otherwise, and that they just need to add and PC. But either way, that's really exciting. I know people were looking for that. I know I definitely wanted that. We can now make much more individualistic. We need the terrain tools as well. That's the next step. But it should let you make much more individualistic habitats and biomes and exhibits in the same park. You can have access on new consoles and assumably PC to the whole breadth of foliage in the game. I think that's really exciting, and definitely looking forward to experiment with that. Income tax and wild capture frequencies have four settings. Yep, cool. All right, last little tidbit of information. Quality of life changes. I don't usually include these, but there's actually some pretty cool ones. Toilets, amenities, and shelters will now be built instantly, just like other buildings, if you've got that setting turned on. And this is actually the one that excites me most. You'll be able to place multiples of the same building without needing to enter the build menu each time. Just hit control left mouse button on keyboard and R3 on controller, which is your right thumbstick. You click that in. Small dinosaurs are being given more behaviours. They'll now be able to raise their heads when walking through water and navigate through areas where they would have been blocked before. So they're going to be more annoying to keep with rocks and stuff if you ever do that. But I love that idea that they'll be walking through the water and they'll try to raise their head so they get above it. You know, because the small dinosaurs do avoid water if they can, but if they have to walk through it, they'll now have an extra behaviour to accommodate, which I think is really cute. And it seems like they'll be able to sneak between rocks, and they've probably been given a smaller hitbox, essentially, in terms of nav mesh. Combat for sauropods has been adjusted to improve the quality of their fights. This is not what you're hoping it is. It is an improvement, however. They will now take damage in chunks rather than continuously, and begin bleeding out once they reach 15% health, so they are going to be a lot sturdier in general. Feedback for when the bleed out state is affecting a dinosaur has been added. You'll be able to manage your injured dinosaurs more efficiently, so you'll just know your dinosaur is bleeding out, which at the moment you can only know by looking at them and seeing their health dropping. To further, this is part of it as well, to further facilitate these changes, hunting behaviours of carnivores have seen some changes. They attack less frequency and may fail a hunt depending on their individual combat stats and the defence level of the sauropod. We've adjusted the UI cohabitation feedback on Ferrozinosaurus, Indominus Rex, Velociraptor and Indoraptor to reflect their likes and dislikes more, which should help you care for them better. So let's focus on this bit. On the left, carnivores are going to attack less frequently. I think that's against sauropods specifically, and may fail the hunt. Now, okay, so the two main changes I want to see to sauropod combat are as follows. One, that they flat out don't attack Brachiosaurus, Mementosaurus, your largest sauropods. You know, there's no planet where a Velociraptor should be attacking a Brachiosaurus. It's nonsense, it shouldn't be in the game. So that is still not here, and that's a bit of a shame. The second thing I think most of us want is the ability for the sauropod to do some damage back, right? Because they're huge creatures. These are titans, especially the Jurassic World Evolution versions. They could crush a Velociraptor underfoot. One little kick out, one little tail whip, one stomp is going to absolutely annihilate some of these smaller carnivores. And the sauropods still don't have that. So this is a little disappointing in that regard. It does seem like they will now just be less like giant meaty punching bags, however. You know, if you've got a Brachiosaurus and a few Velociraptors, maybe they're going to attack it, but hopefully these stats have been balanced well enough to accommodate that, and those Velociraptors may well attack, but hopefully they wouldn't win, which I guess is the key difference. So yeah, a really good free update. It looks really promising. Again, Frontier always brings the heat when it comes to their free updates, and I say you don't need to buy the DLC. Any of you who own the game, this is what you'll all be getting next week. Let me know what aspect of this update you'd be most excited by in the comment section down below. Throw me a like if you enjoyed the video. And I want to quickly say, we will have Jurassic Park Operation Genesis today. I've been meaning to post it the last 3 days, but things keep happening. But I'm just going to post it tonight. It'll be up at some point today, okay? Just getting this out there. Thank you for joining me. Throw me a like down below. Leave a comment, all that kind of jazz. Subscribe if you're new to the channel, yada, yada, yada. Thanks for joining me. Cheers, much love as always. Bye-bye. Reaching out.